Hello, pen friends. Welcome to another video. In today's video, I'm going to be talking about pen shows. And I'm about to head off to the San Francisco Pen Show in just a few days. In fact, by the time this video publishes, I will probably be either on the way to the show or at the show. But I've never really done a video about kind of the whole ecosystem of a pen show, what to expect, what to take, what to prepare, how to pick which pen show to go to, that sort of thing. And that's kind of a big oversight on my part, because in my book, a pen show is the fountain pen hobby experience. It is the purest form of the fountain pen hobby experience. And what I mean by that is that it's fun using your pens. It's great using these wonderful writing instruments or art instruments and inks and even collecting vintage pens and getting into the minutiae. That's great. But what really, really brings the hobby to life for me and for a lot of people are the people in the hobby. The online community has really helped that flourish over the last several years, which is why I think we're seeing a resurgence in interest in pens right now, because the people who are into pens are generally really awesome people. And they get along well with each other, which also helps, generally speaking. So, if you're fairly new to the hobby, you've never been to a pen show, I encourage you to do what you can to attend. It's not always easy. It's not possible in many cases. But if you can, I would try to make it happen. It's really a special experience and one that I enjoy. In fact, when I'm getting burned out by the hobby and kind of tired of being involved with fountain pens, which happens probably far more frequently than I should be comfortable with considering what I do here on YouTube, pretty much the quickest way for me to get back into the swing of things is to go to a pen show, and I get energized and excited and happy about pens all over again. A pen show is kind of like a giant flea market for pen-related stuff. Historically, and even still for the most part, most of a pen show is about buying, selling, and trading of pens, inks, pen-related services, paper, parts, that sort of thing. Commerce is the main reason for these shows. That's the reason they exist. There's a lot more that goes into it than commerce, but commerce is the hub around which everything is built. So when shows first started in the late 70s, early 80s, and then grew through the 80s and 90s, most of the people who came to the shows were collectors. They would go out to antique stores and flea markets and estate sales and find pens that had fallen into disrepair, collect them, restore them, sell the ones they didn't need in their collection, buy ones that they were missing from their collection. It was much more like the fine art collector market than it is today. And a lot of those folks still attend pen shows, and they still really enjoy that aspect of the hobby. So you can go down the aisle and see someone with folder upon folder of one kind of pen in different colors from different ages with different numbers of cap bands and jewels and blah, 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 blah. And that's a big part of pen shows and has been for a really, really long time. Over the past several years, as new people have come into the hobby, particularly those who are users of fountain pens more than collectors of fountain pens, many shows have also started to include retailers of new pens and manufacturers of pens who come to shows to announce their products. So you get retailers like Van Ness Pens and Anderson Pens and Fountain Pen Hospital and Toys in the Attic and Chatterley Luxuries and Crazy Allen's and on and on and on and on. You also get retailers or manufacturers like the Canalea Pen Company or Newton Pens or Sailor will sometimes bring stuff to shows or Stilo Art or. So you get a pretty healthy mix of new and old pens. And that has continued. Even in the 4 or 5 years that I've been in the hobby, I have started to see a shift more toward people bringing new inks, new pens, making, you know, exclusive things that are new to the shows available than even there were when I first attended my first show back in 2015, which is only a couple years ago. Again, commerce is still the main part of that, and that's how people pay for their, you know, pay for their trips. But the tone of pen shows has started to shift a little bit. Some people are really excited by the shift. Some people really don't like it as much and prefer the way it used to be. I will say this. I believe wholeheartedly there is room in this hobby for every single approach to the hobby that you want. Are you a user of fountain pens? Are you a collector? Do you get into the intricacies? Do you want to do repair? Do you want to make your own pens? There is room for everybody in this hobby. It's a very inclusive group. In addition to the show floor, which is generally in the ballroom of a hotel, there is what my pen friend Eleanor once termed pen shows after dark. So most hotels will have a great bar where everyone gets together and they laugh and play and talk and drink and oftentimes drink way too much and show off pens and share their purchases and learn and teach and laugh and laugh and laugh. And it's awesome. Pen shows after dark are without question my favorite part of every pen show. I am one of those, I will walk up and down the aisles of a pen show really fast, get a quick skim, and be good for the rest of the weekend. I don't need to pore over every table. And some people do, and that's fine. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. That's just not me. What I love is going through the show floor, going out to lunch with some of my pen friends, hanging out in the bar afterwards. That is my favorite part. Here in the US, there's basically at least one show every month somewhere. Now, the shows differ in size, they differ in length, they differ in format, they differ in personality. Some shows are going to be more heavily leaning toward the vintage collector market. Others are going to be a little bit more heavily leaning toward new retail. And so you have to look at the personality of the show to determine, what show do I want to go to? The venue in which the show is held is a big part of the personality of the show. What's the space like? Is there a good bar? Are there restaurants nearby? Is there stuff within walking distance? Are you going to be stuck eating in the hotel restaurant the whole time? Do you need to have a rental car? Are there going to be a lot of people hanging out after the show, or is the show floor going to close and everyone going to go their separate ways? And it's hard to know that before going, but that's one thing you want to consider. So obviously, the best show to go to is any show that you can get to. Any show is better than no show. But if you've got a choice of shows, your best bet is to go into some of the online forums or watch some of the YouTube video show recaps and try to figure out which one is going to be the best fit for you. I really liked the DC show in the old location. From what I understand, there were some issues with it in the new location, which is unfortunate. I really, really liked the Chicago show this year. I liked the venue quite a bit, especially the bar. The bar was perfect for pen shows. It was perfect. Probably the best hotel bar for a pen show, for pen shows after dark that I've ever seen. And San Francisco was a lot of fun too. I really enjoyed the San Francisco show. And the San Francisco show's personality is a little bit different. There's still a big part of the commerce aspect of a show there, but in my experience, it feels more like a pen convention than a pen show. They've got a lot of classes, a lot of activities after the show. They've got a band who comes in and plays. So that's something to keep in mind. So how does a pen show work? Well, it's not an easy question to answer. There's always some differences between how each individual show is run. So a show is generally owned by a person or a small group of people or maybe a company, and they choose to run it in different ways. Some of these shows are run in the way they have been run for years and years and years, and they just don't adjust the way that they are run. And that makes it a little tricky for some of the demographic shifts in pen show attendees. Other shows are trying to do new things. Sometimes the way a show is run is dependent on the availability of the hotel staff or whether or not they can lock the ballroom at night or if they have to hire security guards or et cetera, et cetera. So generally speaking, here in the US, a show runs from Thursday through Sunday. It usually starts middle of the day on Thursday, 1-2 o'clock, and people kind of roll in. That's when the traders arrive. And these are, when I say traders, what I mean are the collectors who are bringing the stuff from their personal collection that they want to get rid of. They start looking for things that they're missing from their collection. They meet each other out in the lobby or up in hotel rooms. It's very informal, very casual, not a huge amount of foot traffic. And that's where a lot of the longtime pen show attendees greet each other and catch up since the last pen show. It's a very congenial, friendly environment. Tends to skew more toward the collector side of the hobby. Often on Thursday is also when the larger retailers with the large spreads that are complex and take a lot of time set up. So they're not open for sales. You know, they might sell something to you as they're setting up, but generally speaking, they're not open for sales. They're just setting up their displays. And it'll take them several hours to do that often. And then at the end of the day on Thursday, the show is shut down, displays are covered up, the doors are locked, and everyone's kicked out of the ballroom. And that's when the fun starts in my book. So they go out, the vendors and retailers and traders go out to dinner. They hang out in the bar. People start coming in for the show on Friday. A lot of times people will fly in on Thursday night and their first experience at the pen show will be meeting folks at the bar. So that's where the fun really starts in my book. Friday is where people start to really get into the pen show. This is where, in my book, where the show really starts. For most shows, Friday is also a trader day. So if you want to do anything on Thursday, you want to walk through the show on Thursday or on Friday, you have to get what's known as a trader pass or a weekend trader pass. They're usually more expensive, but they will get you access to the show the whole weekend. And that's where you, Dicker, and again, this is a little more heavy on the vintage collectors and that sort of thing, but this is also where the retailers, larger retailers, start to sell. Now, in the last few years, the number of people who come and get a trader pass for the whole weekend has grown. And the people who are coming are more interested in, I'm a fountain pen user than a fountain pen collector. So you are starting to see much higher amounts of traffic on Fridays than you used to. A lot of people are coming. That's why, you know, I often work at the Van Ness table, or the Andersons often have bloggers helping them out, Franklin Christoph. That's why a lot of these new manufacturers and retailers are selling on Friday, and they often do pretty good business on Friday. Friday night is often a blast in the bar. Sometimes there's a little party, sometimes there isn't. It just kind of depends. Then you get to Saturday, and usually for most shows, Saturday is what they call a public day. It's where you can come and buy a day pass just for that day. Often the public hours are a little bit later. So if you're a trader, you can come in maybe at 8 o'clock, and you can't come in until 10 o'clock if you have a day pass. It depends on the show. Each show has different rules, so you'll need to try to do some research on that depending on which show you're interested in. And usually Saturday is the busiest day of the show. It's where everyone who lives in the area and has to work will come on Saturday. Obviously, Saturday's a weekend, so people can come in. There's still all the vintage collector sales and a lot of the new, you know, user sales, but it's going to be crowded. There's going to be a lot of people. That is often, some vendors won't even set up until Friday and won't start selling until Saturday. So you might see new vendors that you didn't see on Friday or Thursday. And then Sunday is an unusual day in most shows. It's a public day often, but come about 1 or 2 o'clock in the afternoon, things start to peter off. A lot of the traders, the people who had their personal collections laid out and are trying to do the trading, start to pack up their stuff and go. A lot of people, rather than pay for a hotel on Sunday night, fly out on Sunday. So they have to leave early to get to the airport and fly out. So Sunday, if you're going to go on Sunday, I would suggest getting there early. Some of the traders don't even show up on Sunday. They've done what they need to do. They're worn out. They're kind of burned out. So they don't show up, or they leave their stuff up in the room and they go walk around the show floor. if you're going to come on a public day on Sunday, just be aware it's going to be a truncated experience. Most of the retailers and the manufacturers will stay until the end of the day on Sunday, and they'll sell up until the end. But come 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock, it's all hell breaks loose to pack everything up, get everything loaded into individual cars and vans, and shut the ballroom down. Because they have to often have to be out of the ballroom by 6 o'clock so that hotel staff can break all the tables down and clean it out and prepare it for whatever it's going to be used for the next day. What I will tell you is, having worked at a vendor's table before, when the show starts to shut down, be polite and stop dragging out your purchases. We often have to hurry quickly, and you know, people are buying up until the very last second. We're, you know, we're putting stuff in boxes and taking it down, and they're saying, well, do you have this ink? And do you have this ink? And a lot of times that ink is boxed up and buried somewhere, or it's already out in the van or whatever. So what I would tell you is, if you see people breaking things down, the show's over. It's time to go. You know, you can hang around and talk and chat and stuff like that, but just be aware that the folks behind the table have a job to do. They've got to do it quickly. They've got to do it thoroughly, and they got to get out. And then we'll chat with you at the bar afterwards. Now, each show has a slightly different personality. The LA show, for instance, Thursday, the year I went, Thursday and for the first half of Friday, the ballroom wasn't available, and or most of the ballroom wasn't available. And so a lot of traders and retailers couldn't set up their tables. They had to wait until the end of the day on Friday. So the show floor was very small. People were a little frustrated. You didn't really get the full show experience until Saturday. And even then, the LA show, the year I went, Saturday was not a public day. If you wanted to go on Saturday, you had to get a weekend pass. And then you could go to the show. The show, Sunday was the public day. But again, Sunday was a truncated day. So come 2 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon, even though that was the public day, things were starting to shut down. San Francisco, on the other hand, you can set up on Thursday. There's not a lot of foot traffic on Thursday. But Friday, Saturday, and Sunday are all public days. But if you're a trader, you can get in early. So you can get, you know, it might not start until noon or 10 o'clock on Friday. I think it's noon on Friday and 10 o'clock on Saturday, 10 o'clock on Sunday, but the floor opens up at 8. So if you want to come in for a couple hours ahead of time, you can do that. Now, if you buy a day pass, you're only going to get the pass for that one day. So in general, it's still better to buy the trader pass because you get early access and you get to come for all 3 days and that sort of thing, rather than buy a new pass every single day. So you're going to want to check with your individual show to say, what are the rules for how my show works? And check their websites. Now, a little word about pen show websites. They're terrible, almost uniformly. I can think of a couple of exceptions that I won't name here. But generally speaking, pen show websites are terrible. You often cannot purchase your tickets in advance on the website, which boggles my mind. That seems insanity. It's not hard to do. And allow me to go off on a little rant. If you own, organize, or run a pen show, fix your website. Fix it. Sell your tickets online. It's not that hard. Call me. I will show you how to do it. It's not that hard. Some shows, you can't even pay with a credit card. You just got to either pay with cash or give them a check. It's like, it's time to bring pen shows into the 21st century, into the second decade of the 21st century. End scene, end rant, slash rant. Anyway, so if you can't find what you're looking for on the pen show website, check for a Facebook group or go to the online forums and ask. People in the online forums you'll basically be able to find someone on the online forums who has been to every pen show. They'll be able to tell you what the rules are and how it works and that sort of thing. Okay, so you've picked your pen show. You kind of figured out what the personality of the pen show is going to be like. You understand how it's going to work. So what do you bring? Now, there are lots of videos about this, and I'm not going to rehash all of them, but what I will tell you is this. Pen show floors get hot. So wear cool clothing, even if it's in the middle of the winter. You know, bring a short sleeve shirt or two, because it's probably going to get real warm in that ballroom. Wear comfortable shoes. This is not a fashion show. you will be happy you wore your tennis shoes rather than your 4-inch stilettos. Trust me on this. I mean, my 4-inch stilettos kill after a day at a pen show. Kidding. Or am I? So tennis shoes, comfortable shoes, whatever you got to do. You want to look nice, that's fine, but still make sure you're comfortable because you're going to be on your feet all day doing a lot of walking. The last time I attended a pen show where I wasn't standing behind the table, I think I did 12,000 steps that day. So you are not going to be wanting to wear uncomfortable shoes. Depending on the hotel's location, you're probably going to want to bring some snacks or get yourself to a grocery store when you get there and buy some snacks. It may not be easy to get to restaurants. There may not be good food options at the hotel, or they may be really, really expensive. So bring some snacks. One of the things that I am shocked people don't bring to pen shows is a notebook. Grab a little pocket notebook, or I've got a paper for fountain pens Tomoe River notebook that I take with me to every pen show. There's going to be inks to sample. There's going to be pens to sample. Bring paper you know. Many of these retailers aren't going to have paper for you to use, or it might be paper you're not familiar with. Plus, if you're going to sample inks or you're going to try other people's pens, you want to keep track of the stuff you like so you can look for it yourself or look for it in the future. A really good example of this is at the San Francisco show, the entire middle row of tables are these trays of inexpensive pens that have been inked with 700 different inks. And you can sit at the table for hours and sample all these different inks. And you've got this list of colors in your notebook and you go, oh, I like that one. I like that one. I like that one. You go to the vendors and say, hey, do you have this ink? And they'll tell you, well, no, we didn't bring it, or no, it's no longer in production. You can go home, you know, put a star next to it, go home and order it. You gotta have a notebook with you. Keep track of what you use. The other thing is, if someone hands you a pen and you can say, oh, can I try it? Whip out a little pocket notebook. It's how you're going to learn what you like writing with. You got to have paper. Bring your own paper. Make sure it's paper you know, paper you like, paper you understand how ink and pens work against it. If you like a paper with a little more texture, do that. It also really helps you if you're going to have your nibs ground, to have them ground and try it on the paper you plan on using the nib with. That'll help. Trust me. Shocks me the number of people who do not bring paper. If you don't bring paper, go to someone who's got it and buy it. You need to have your own notebook. And rant number two. Many people at the pen shows bring backpacks. I would not recommend this. Backpacks are bulky. The show floors often get very crowded. You're going to be hitting people with your backpack. I'd bring an over-the-shoulder bag of some kind if you have to have a bag. Many people bring fishing vests. It's a kind of a running joke that if you, you know, if you're someone at a pen show, you should be wearing a fishing vest. A joke that I have fully bought into by having my own custom fishing vest made. So you're going to want something to carry stuff, especially if you're going to be buying a lot of things. Some of the vendors aren't going to have plastic bags for you. It's not like going to a grocery store. So you need to make sure that you've got a bag of some kind to carry what you buy. You're going to be carrying it in your hands, leaving the show floor, dropping it off at your hotel, that sort of thing. Bring water. A lot of shows will have water for you out in the lobby area, but not all of them. Some of them won't have a drinking fountain available. You should have a water bottle. You will get dehydrated at these shows. The air is very dry. It's very warm. There's lots of people. You're walking all day. You may find you're skipping meals, even though you don't intend to. So bring water. That's important as well. Now we come to the age-old question about pen shows. Can I use my credit cards or do I need to bring cash? And I will answer that question by saying yes. Many retailers, especially, and I'm gonna stereotype here, and I don't mean to, but it's kind of true. Many of the people who have brick and mortar stores and younger vendors will accept cards. Many of them will accept payment via PayPal, which you can also do with a card. So you can pay a lot of vendors like that. Some will only accept cash. And many who do accept cards will give you a discount if you pay with cash. So they'll knock a couple percent off, because they don't have to pay the processing fees, that sort of thing. Now, if it's a $50 pen, a couple percent's not going to make much difference. If it's a $1,200 pen, it could make a difference. So that's something to keep in mind. When I go to shows, I generally bring cash, but I will choose to pay with a card if I can. And there's not a huge markup for paying with a card. The reason I do that is because I have rewards cards. So I get rewards for my purchases. I would rather pay with my card, get the rewards. I don't like carrying a ton of cash around with me, so I will often leave my cash in a safe in my room. And then I'll do that. But if I run across something I want from a vendor who only accepts cash, then I will pay for cash. And that works out well. Now, if you have self-control issues, like I do, cash is a really good way of keeping you in your budget. Leave your cards in the room, carry only cash, and then when you run out of cash, you are done buying. Some people like doing that. I can't function that way, but that's just something to keep in mind. What do you do at a pen show? What are you going to do at a pen show? How is the pen show going to work for you? I'll tell you what I do. I don't bring a to-do list. I don't bring a list of things I'm looking at. For me, the greatest part of a pen show is discovering stuff I didn't even know I wanted. Part of the problem with coming to a show with a list of stuff you want, I'm not saying it's bad, there's pluses and minuses. One of the pluses of doing that is you can often find what you want, and it's stuff that you were going to get anyway. One of the minuses is you limit yourself to stuff you had only considered ahead of time. A really good example of something that I got that I never would have gotten had I had a list ahead of time, I've got several of them. One was the Wall Eversharp Deco Band. I didn't even know that pen existed and that it was coming out. I learned about it the first time at the show. Same thing with my Kanalea Kahakai. Same thing with my Tibaldi Impero. Same thing with my Stilo Art Tot. A lot of the pens I've purchased not because I was looking for them, but because I stumbled across them. That's why I don't bring a to-do list. But I do this. So if I'm just attending a show, I'm not working the show, usually I will go on Friday and I will scour the aisles and find stuff I'm interested in. If there's anything that I have to have, I just absolutely have to have, I'll buy it right then and there. But generally speaking, I choose not to buy anything until Sunday. Saturday at the show is often a public day and it's often really crowded. And so Saturday is where it's a more casual day for me, where I meet my friends in the aisles. I see what they've been getting. I might buy some chocolates from Brandon Lee, the chocolatier who makes the best chocolates. He's at a lot of the pen shows. Or chat with my vendor friends or that sort of thing. But I try not to take up too much time of the people at the table because the show floor is crazy. They're busy. And in my book, Saturday is not the best day to try to socialize. Now, I work at a vendor's table most shows these days. I often work at the Van Ness Pens table. And what I will tell you is I love to socialize with people. I love to greet people who have seen my videos and you know, like the work I do, and it's awesome. And I will always take the time to do that. That being said, my ask and my recommendation to you is just try to be cognizant of what's going on at the table. If you come by the table and you see we are mobbed with people, and I'm not just talking about Van Ness pens, I'm talking about any trader, any vendor, try not to take up a ton of our time right then and there. Most of the vendors are around all day long. Most of the vendors will be in the bar afterwards and would love to meet with you then. Like I'm happy to say hi. I'm happy to take a selfie. I'm happy to chat if the time exists. If it doesn't, come back by in 15 minutes. Things go in waves. And so sometimes it'll be really busy, sometimes not so much. And we love to meet people. Love it, love it, love it. But just be aware of that. And I've heard some, not vendors, but traders complaining in the past that they've had to work really, really hard to make a sale because people come and drill them for questions, drill them for, you know, information, which is awesome. And they're happy to do it. But in so doing, 15 or 16 people walk by who are looking at the pens, but they don't want to turn away from you and say, how can I help you? So just be aware of that and try to be cognizant of it enough to say, oh, you're busy, please take care of them. I'd love to ask you a couple more questions. Maybe I'll be back by in a little bit. But you know, be aware that a big part of the show floor is these people got to make money. And socialization is awesome, but just be polite about it, is all I got to say. Which is why on Saturday, if I'm not working a show, I'm just out there. That's where I like to meet people and say hi and do the selfies and that sort of thing. Because that is my favorite part of the show, is the people. So I try not to interrupt the vendors and stuff like that. So when Sunday rolls around, Sunday for me is the day to kind of take stock of everything I've seen at the show, take stock of my purchases, figure out how much money I still want to spend, and then go pick up whatever's left that I just couldn't get out of my head. So a perfect example of that, I've really gotten into the late, mid-1930s Parker Vacuumatics, the oversizes. And I'd been looking at a couple of them all weekend. There was one at one particular table that I was like, I really like this pen. I don't need another one, but I really like it. Sunday came around and I was like, I've been thinking about this pen all weekend long. It's got an amazing nib. It's in pristine condition. I think I'm going to go get it. And the way I look at it is, if it's not there when I go back on Sunday, it wasn't meant to be. So that's kind of where I stand on it. If it's not there on Sunday, then it wasn't meant to be, and I'm okay with that. Anything that I will be devastated if I don't get, I buy right then and there. Something to keep in mind as you're going through. So I've talked a little bit about etiquette at the pen shows, but let me talk about it a little bit more. First and foremost, please do not pick up a pen unless you ask first. This is less important with new pens. It's still important, but you want to make sure that the table you are at is okay with you picking up their pens. Some folks, and I don't really agree with this personally, but some folks will put a sign up that says, please do not touch pens. They're very protective of their pens. These are collections that they've spent decades and tens or hundreds of thousands of dollars building, and they're very protective of them. I understand it, but you're at a show, people want to touch the pens. That being said, it is polite to say, hey, is it all right if I take a closer look at this pen? 99 times out of 100, the person's going to say, yes, absolutely. But they're going to watch you because they don't want you walking off with the pen. They don't want, if it's a twist cap, they don't want you pulling the cap off, that sort of thing. And if you don't know how the pen works, ask. Don't experiment with it at the table. You're going to give heart palpitations to people if you do that. It's a great place to learn about these vintage pens, but remember, these pens are 50, 60, 70, 80, 100 years old. They're delicate. They're perishable almost. Be very, very careful with them. If you're looking for a flex nib, a really good way to test flex is to just bounce the nib slightly on your thumbnail. You'll see people thumbnailing the nibs a lot just to see, does it give any bounce? Don't try to max out the flex when you do that. Just use it to check out the feel. Again, only if you've asked permission to pick up and handle the pens. Many people will let you dip a pen to test it. But only do that if you're really serious about buying the pen. If it looks like the person who is selling pens is a collector of pens, they've got bazillion varieties of one type of pen, like a bunch of Schaefer's or a bunch of Parker Vacs or a bunch of old Watermans, whatever it is, they may not let you do that. You can ask, but over time you start to learn, is this the kind of vendor who's going to let me use the pen, or are they really a collector? What I would say is if the vendor appears to be a serious collector, chances are they're not going to let you ink their pens because dip testing the pens, because dip testing the pens will in many ways cause problems. They're going to have to clean out the pen. And when you've got hundreds of pens, that can be really tricky to do. If it's a new old stock, it may lower the value of the pen. So the answer may well be no, and you need to be okay with that. You may go from table to table and people be like, hey, how can I help you? You may go from table to table and you'll see someone sitting behind the table like this. It is what it is. Not everyone's going to be happy. The pen hobby is full of introverts and socially awkward people. That's why we all love it so much, because we're around our own people. Some people are going to be really ebullient and outgoing and fun and extroverted, and other people aren't. And so if you've got a question, you can ask, read the room. If it feels like the person is just like, stop talking to me, you're an idiot, I don't care about you, it's fine. Stand up, move along. I don't think you'll find that very often. That's not common. But stand up, move along, you'll be okay. You know, there's lots of people who are happy to chat with you and happy to show you the ins and outs. And if you're curious about who some of those folks are, if you're like, hey, I really want to find a vintage pen, but I need someone to help show me the ropes, come to the Van Ness table or come to some of the bloggers that you know and say, I'm looking for a vintage pen. Who do I go to? We'll point you to certain people, because there are certain people out there who either have really good stuff or are really friendly and they're going to help you figure it out, or they've got just a ton of stuff at really good prices. So as you start to know, you know, ask your pen friends, ask some of the bloggers you know, ask some of the vendors you know and are familiar with, and they'll point you to the right place. No one is really so egotistical at pen shows, has been my experience, that they're going to say, well, I'm not going to tell you that. That person's my competitor. In a lot of ways, I don't feel like most of the vendors at the shows treat each other like competitors, because we're all in the same hobby together and we all want it to grow together. So we work together to help the attendees have the best experience they can. Generally, don't bring your food into the show. It's kind of tacky. Unless you really know what you're doing, don't really try to super flex a pen. It freaks us out. It freaks me out. It took me a long time to learn how to write with a flex pen, and I still probably don't do it well. But there you go. Now, after the show, in the bar, pen shows after dark, a lot of those rules kind of fall by the wayside, because it's no longer about selling. It's no longer about a person's time. It's about socializing and having fun and getting to know people. So people will bring their pens and lay them out on the table and say, look, take a look, use whatever you want. You know, if you happen to be at a show with Lay Reyes, who does, you know, beautiful artwork and calligraphy on Instagram, she comes to a lot of shows and teaches classes. She's got a collection of Nakaya pens that is just astonishing. And she's got no problem laying out this $20,000 worth of Nakaya pens and saying, try them out, have fun, take a look, use them. You know, she's a user of fountain pens, and she wants everyone else to be a user of fountain pens too. And it's awesome. I generally do the same thing. I used to bring my entire pen collection. I don't do that anymore, A, because it just takes too long to put it all in the folders, and it's really heavy and hard to travel with on planes. But also because I don't ink up most of my pens to travel, so it's silly to bring a bunch of uninked pens. But in the bar, I'll bring my Franklin Christoph 13, Lucky 13 penvelope down and my notebook, and we'll pass pens around and ink around, and it's a great time. Again, it's always good to ask. If you don't know, ask. But generally speaking, if you see people passing pens around, they're happy for you to pick it up. Be very delicate. If you don't know how to take the cap off, ask. If you don't know if it's a flex nib or not, ask. Ask. It's always better to ask than to assume and damage someone's pen. So that is the show in a nutshell. I love going to pen shows. I love it to death. So what's it like behind the table? I'll give you a little bit of a quick view there, since that's not something I've seen a lot talked about. I usually fly into a show on Thursday. I often, because of when I like to leave the airport, get there a little bit before I can check in. So I hang out in the lobby. I try to time it so I get there at the same time as whoever's table I'm working at. As they get there, I will help them unload the van, put up the racks, stack the racks with ink, lay out the pens, generally get ready. And that usually takes 2 to 3, sometimes 4 hours, depending on how complex the setup. And we laugh and we get caught up. And that's about the same time some of my blogger friends and some of my friends from previous shows start showing up, and they've got trader passes. So even though they're not there buying anything, they're there hanging out and chatting and laughing and having fun. And sometimes they'll just help us set up, which is awesome because it makes things go so much faster. It's when you've got, you know, the Van Ness table that I work at, they've got a wall of ink and they bring a lot of unusual varieties of ink and a lot of colors. And so we have to alphabetize those colors. And it's like, reminds me of my days working at the public library in the town where I grew up in Michigan. Then we go out for dinner, usually on Thursday night, and hang out at the bar. Again, very low key, very fun, lots of laughter. Friday morning starts usually pretty early. I'll usually get up at 6:30, 7 o'clock, depending on what time the show starts. Last year, the San Francisco show started at 7 a.m. And so I was up at about 5:30. They provided breakfast for the vendors. So I came down and had some pastries and coffee and such, and then went in, pulled the covers off the table, you know, got the money set up, got ready to go, did some cleanup and arranging of pens, and then people started showing up. And I will tell you that even on Friday at the San Fran show, it was non-stop. It did not stop all day long. So we talk about pens. We help people find the right color of ink. A lot of times they'll say, I'm looking for this. I'm looking for a sepia. I'm looking for a real ultramarine. And I've got enough experience with ink. I mean, look at this is just one of my three color rings that I'm working on right now. This is organized in order of colors. So we help people track down the ink they're looking for. It's a lot of fun. Now, that can take a lot of time. And you have to realize that if I spend 15 minutes helping someone do that and they buy one $10 bottle of ink, that's not really a great trade-off in terms of time and effort. But we love doing it anyway. sometimes I'll help people try out pens, swap out nibs, adjust the nibs for them. We'll dip test pens for you to try. Again, bring your own paper. We have paper, but it may not be good paper. And sometimes it's hard for us to find the notebook under all the stuff we've got. Sometimes I stand out in front of the table and talk with folks. Sometimes I'm behind the table. At shows, vendors very often don't even get a chance to run to lunch. Fortunately, for the Van Ness table, there's usually three or four of us there. So one of us will, during lunch hour, will run and go grab lunch, and then we'll eat in shifts. Sometimes that's not possible for all vendors. So, you know, be aware of that if things get a little slow during the lunch hours because someone probably had to go pick up lunch. Some of the hotels have started offering a paid lunch where you can go out and buy a sandwich and stuff. It's usually way overpriced, not very good, but really convenient. So sometimes we'll do that as well. Toward the end of the day, we will pack up the pens and carry them out, not leave them on the table. It depends on whether or not the ballroom is locked overnight. If it's not, we absolutely take all the valuables with us. If it is, often we'll take them with us anyway. It's safer than leaving thousands of dollars worth of pens out on the table. Then Friday night, there's often some sort of an event that happens. We will often go out to dinner with different vendors, different distributors or something, you know, who want to take the vendors out to dinner. Then Saturday, again, we start very early. We get the table ready and get ready for the influx of people. And Saturday is truly nonstop. It goes all day long. It's fun. It's a lot of fun, actually. I love it. I like working the shows more than I like just attending the shows. I love doing that. It's a blast. Again, we will do count cash and swipe credit cards and package stuff up and send people to tables that have stuff we don't, and, you know, accept people from other tables that have stuff that they don't, and ooh and ah over people's purchases and help them pick the right colors. It's so much fun. Then Saturday night, there is almost always an event of some kind. It's usually sponsored by one of the distributors or retailers. Sometimes they'll show off new stuff. Sometimes they'll do giveaways. I know at San Francisco, we're doing a fun new thing where it's called, it's a basically like speed dating, but with pens. So there's going to be tables set up, and every 10 minutes you have to go to a different table to learn new things and about pens. So it's going to be great for people who are just new to the hobby or want to try a bunch of different stuff. There's also going to be some drinks and a band playing and some dancing. And so it should be a lot of fun. It should be a blast. Sundays, usually by then we are worn out. So Sundays mornings involve a metric butt ton of coffee. And yes, that is an actual measurement. stumbling around, often with a mild hangover from the night before. If you're a drinker, it's very calm, very slow. Again, we set up, but a lot of the inventory is gone. So easier setup, you know, cleaning up the tables and fixing the holes and cleaning the shelves and that sort of thing. And then we sell. And again, things start to slow down toward the end of the day. People start to take off. Come 4 or 5 o'clock, whenever the show shuts down, it's all hands on deck to break everything down, pack it back into the boxes, and get the van loaded up. And that's the show. And then usually Sunday night at the is just hanging out at the bar. We usually go to a really nice dinner somewhere, not the hotel. You know, we pile into the van or pile into rental cars and go somewhere away. Just to get away from the crowds and have quiet and a nice meal and kind of bask in the joy of a very nice, another wonderful show. Then we'll come back to the hotel and stay up until 11 or midnight, drinking and playing with pens and just being in each other's company and enjoying the afterglow of the show. And then I usually go to bed around midnight, get up early, and head right over to the airport first thing in the morning. And that's my show. And I love it. I know I've said that several times, but it's true. I love it. The San Fran show for me this year is, I actually have a goal not to buy a single thing this show. I want to go to see people and to help people find what they want to buy. And I'm not planning on buying a dang thing. In fact, I'm planning on selling several things at the show. So in any case, I hope you've enjoyed this very long, rambly overview of what a show is, how to attend a show, what to expect. In any case, thank you so much for watching, if you have managed to watch all of this. And hopefully we will see you at some show in the future. I don't know what my shows for 2018 are going to be. For 2017, San Fran's going to be my last one. But for 2018, I'm sure I will figure it out. I will probably make Chicago again because I like the Chicago show and it gives me a good excuse to go back and visit my my grandmother in Indiana. And we'll see about the other show. At some point, I'd like to get to the Toronto show. It's one day show and I wouldn't be working and I'd just be attending, but I want to go to Toronto. I'm so upset I didn't get to meet Stephen Brown and Aziza at the DC show this year. So I really want to try to get to meet them in person. I feel bad. We've talked online for so long and I've never had a chance to meet them in person. So, all right. My throat is dry. My eyes are crossing. I have talked for a long time. Thank you so much for watching, and we will see you soon here on another video on The Pen Habit. Bye.